PowerPoint presentations, then what we could do is that we could talk about this figure here, which you probably cannot see everything on, but I would like to introduce it. In the past days, you have been looking at probabilistic methods, and the focus of this course is, of course, value of information in structural health monitoring. But in order to appreciate what we can do with this domain of research, it has been necessary that we talk about more basic concepts in probabilistic modeling and reliability analysis, looking at systems, looking at components, looking at the background. For probabilistic modeling and analysis in engineering. And part of the big challenge is to get a hold on how we actually model the performance of the systems which we are looking at and we are trying to engineer. And trying to engineer involves a number of issues which I will come back to, but generally what we sometimes do, and the Joint Committee has proposed a kind of model basis where we look at what we call exposures acting on the systems. So this is the system, and then we have that the exposures, they may lead to effects on the system which we are looking at, and those effects can generate consequences. We will also come back to that briefly. And we separate between what we call direct and indirect consequences and the degree to which we have direct consequences we measure through what we call vulnerability of the system. So to what degree does it get damaged due to the exposures, and then to what degree do these damages propagate further on and develop what we call indirect consequences, and the connection between the direct and the indirect consequences we try to describe by the concept of robustness. So will a small damage to the system, or will a certain amount of damage to the system, will that propagate into further consequences and failures in the system? Now when we talk about integrity management and structural health monitoring, what we can do is that we can of course observe the system at different levels. So you can look at the exposures, what is happening to the system, and how is the system performing in terms of damages and propagation of failures due to the damages. So there are different levels we can look at the system, we can monitor, we can measure, we can achieve knowledge on the performance of the system at these three stages, and we can control the risks. So that's the whole idea. Knowledge facilitates that we can do something, but only, I mean, and this is very important, and most of us probably do not fully appreciate that knowledge is only of value if we connect the knowledge we have with actions we may take. So it's the actions which we may take based on the knowledge we are able to observe which facilitates management of the system, the performances of the system, the risks or the reliability or the safety or the robustness or the vulnerability or whatever characteristic describing the performance of the system which we would like to manage, right? So looking at this, I call it a desktop model because that is what it is. It is only something we can formulate and describe on the desktop, and of course it relates to a real structure which we are trying to model, right? So we do the best we can to make a model, and then what we are able to do is that we are able to observe how the actual structure is doing. We can relate those observations to indicators to our desktop model, and then we can start playing around. So based on our desktop model, we can get an idea on what eventually it would be good to do to the real structure or the real system in reality, right? Of course, we should not forget that it's only a desktop model. And typically, even though we can make quite nice and advanced models using mechanics and probabilistic mechanics, it will only be like a shadow of reality. And therefore, whatever we can observe, we can feed in to our desktop model and we can make it better, right? So we can do Bayesian updating, we can adapt models, and in this way we get closer and closer to the reality which we are interested in. And then by combining observations with decision rules, we are able to optimize strategies for actually changing, so physically making changes to our model, like making a repair or strengthening a part of the of the system we're dealing with, or trying to reduce the direct contact between the possible exposures and the system which we are trying to manage. Or what we can do is that we can decide, so the decision alternatives also at stake, which only are aiming to collect additional information. So not changing the physics, but trying to get more knowledge about what is going on. And whereas most engineers, they have a tendency, it's just like medical doctors, right? You have medical doctors who are focusing on diagnosing and then finding some pills. And then there are some medical doctors, they were born in a knife in the hand, so they want to make physical changes. So any disease, that be a flu or just a cold, has a medication with a knife, right? Normally, engineers are focusing on exchanging parts of a system, a structure, making repairs, or building something new. But in many cases, it actually makes sense to simply just to try to get more knowledge and feed that knowledge into the models, which then facilitates that we can evaluate, let's say, physical means for managing the performance of the system. And what this course is ultimately about is establishing such models, which facilitates that we are able to see, based on the knowledge we have when we are trying to assess it, to what extent would additional knowledge on these different parts of the model complex provide value by facilitating that we are able in a better way to rank decision alternatives on physical changes of the system. And of course, that also includes always the option of doing nothing, right? So that's basically where I suppose that you are now. You have an idea on, a good idea, I hope, right? You had an exam yesterday? No. Anyway, you will have an exam one of these days on how well you are able to do this modeling here. And what we will talk about today really now concerns on how to throw a formalism on decision analysis on this modeling, facilitating that we can actually see what value potentially achievable information could provide for the management of the system. That's the idea. Okay? Any questions? Now, since you have read the books and you have looked through the lecture material for today, I suggest that instead of me lecturing, that we simply have an hour and a half of questions. No.
We got the lectures that didn't fly.
That didn't fly. Okay. Yes, you see, I had a list of contents, and it's very advanced, so this is important information, a preamble, then a little bit about literature, and then 1 point, actually 2 points. These are the two main points here, but of course. And then also, this is slide number 3 of God knows how many. So I didn't want to make you scared, so I didn't want to write the number. I don't know if you are normally having a break at some point in time, but maybe we could aim for a break in 45 minutes. Is that okay? Are there any possibilities for coffee at that point in time somewhere?
The next coffee break is strictly scheduled at 10.
Okay, that's after my lecture, right?
Yeah.
We will try for a 5 minutes break in 45 minutes, and then we will just continue again. Okay. Yes, preamble. The important thing is not to stop questioning. Curiosity has its own reason for existing, and that was a really clever guy who came up with that, among many other good observations. I would say that if you, and you should be curious, so after today, maybe when you get back home, wherever you are, then please remember to buy on Amazon an old version or whatever. You can buy them relatively inexpensively on Amazon, the Reifer and Schleifer, a book on applied statistical decision theory. This thing here, we have available in PDF, so you don't need to buy it. If you're interested, you can have it. There are some of the material which I'm going to talk about today is also covered by this lecture note. Then this book here you already know of, and then if you want to see, let's say, a more practical example on using value of information analysis in structural health monitoring, then one of the examples which will illustrate that is collected in this paper. And of course there are lots of other papers. I believe that the whole thing there are like two phases in the development of value of information analysis in structural health monitoring. And the second wave started around this point in time, a little bit earlier, around the group of Armin, their colleague in Berkeley. Well, the context of decision analysis in engineering is that we have facilities, we have involving a lot of structures, and they're subjected to a number of scenarios where what we call exposure events are acting on them. They can lead to wear and tear and different types of damages and failures in different types of situations. And we need to be able to manage that in a safe way for the people who are exposed in one way or the other. But of course, it's also really important that these facilities are operating efficiently, optimally, to provide whatever functionality they're supposed to provide. And that really matters, and this is not so easy because things actually do fail or do get worn out and need to be exchanged or need to be repaired. And these facilities, they are quite big and complex in many cases. So it is a tremendously important decision problem on how to do this optimally. And well, many things can happen. Accidents can happen of different types, and as I indicated, also a degradation phenomena like fatigue. Here, I just take the offshore application area as an example, but I also wanted to point at the offshore application area. Not too many of you are from that domain. And I want to highlight that probabilistic modeling and analysis and decision making based on risk information was quite early utilized in this particular application domain. So if you want to try to look at the other systems in engineering, and maybe you cannot find too many examples or too much literature in that particular area, then have a look at what they did in offshore engineering, right? Because they were maybe out 15 or 20 years earlier in that domain than in other domains. Now, what we are able to do using risk-informed decision support is that we can actually quantify the knowledge which we have related to the structural performance, and we can update this based on information we achieve in any way. What we also can do is that we can, and this is what we are going to look at much more today, we can quantify the value of additional information which has not yet been achieved. And we can find a scheme. We have a very formalized scheme on how to optimize and rank decision alternatives for the management. And what is often being a little bit forgotten is that an important aspect of all this is that we based on a clean and straight and honest management of the knowledge we have about the systems, only then are we able to actually also document why we are doing what we are doing and not doing also what we could have done, right? And this is this is something we always should be able to do. So when people ask us, but why are you recommending this, then we cannot just say, experience shows that this is a good idea, or I feel that this is the right thing to do, or if we don't do it, I cannot sleep in the night, or things like that. But you're laughing, but this is just so often the case. One typical example, which makes me goosebump, right? Is when people they go out to observe something, or they go to the laboratory to do some tests. And you can always ask, but why are you doing this? And why are you doing it like the way you have? So why are you doing it in the way you're doing it? So why in this way? Why not in another way? And it's basically almost impossible to get reasonable answers for that. After today, I hope you will be able to help turning around a little bit the community to focus more on how and why we are collecting the information we are collecting. Yeah, as I indicated, this is generally the modeling of consequences which we are generally using when we're looking at systems. So this could be any system. This is completely generic. Any engineered system, we're looking at exposure events. They're acting on the system. Exposure events could be extreme waves, could be wind. It could be chloride trying to ingress into a concrete structure. It could be some stresses caused by time-varying loading, and then in having the effect to change the system physically, right? So this is a system change, and in the figure I showed you initially, we had direct and indirect consequences described by the performance characteristics, vulnerability and robustness, right? And that leads to contributions to the total consequences. So we call this part here of the consequences event-imposed consequences. But then due to the system change, due to what actually factually happens to the system we are dealing with, there may also be, and that is tremendously important, but we will not talk about this in this lecture, namely, how is that perceived by people? So we are losing things here, we are losing assets, we are losing some lives, we are losing a platform, we have severe damages down on the seabed, on the well, and we are damaging the entire Gulf of Mexico for I don't know how many years, right? And other industries like the shrimp, the shrimpers on the American side basically disappeared for a very long period of time, etc., etc. So there's lots of consequences here. But the perception of what happened had a lot of additional consequences to society. And of course, we also need to take them into account when we are trying to manage the system, right? And what for sure we want to avoid is that the perception consequences are not out of tune with what have happened. So we don't want to have any overreactions. But what we see in reality is that we almost always have overreactions and very bad political decisions made in the aftermath or when something goes seriously wrong, right? And how can we try to manage that? I will just give you the clue. Information. So communication is the way to manage this type of risk here. And then I'll not say more about that. Yeah, so again we have the real world over here. We are able to make observations, measurements, and that feeds into the possibility of optimizing decisions. And there are lots of things we can do in order to try to manage the system representing our picture of the real world, right? And that's what we talked a little bit about before. And many of those activities, many of those measures for the management involve collection of new information. And again, what you have learned about is how to formulate probabilistic models which are relevant when we are trying to model the real world here. So a joint probabilistic description of the exposure events, and then fundamentally what we need to be able to do is to model all the individual scenarios which leads from exposure events to direct consequences and to indirect consequences. And I would like, so I'm not doing this with you, but keep in mind what you really want to do is to be able to model the scenarios of these evolutions of consequences probabilistically. Then I know that there sometimes have been a little bit of confusion on the concept of observations and indicators and stuff like that. But one way of looking at the picture here is that you have a facility, right? And you would like to observe something on utilize information from this facility to try to manage the facility. And you can imagine that some event takes place, and this event may be observed, and that now relates in some sort of data which can be stored. Now, what we need to be able to do in order to take benefit from this data is that we need to establish a relationship between the data and some sort of indicator related to the performance of the structure, a typical performance type of relation. So an indicator can an indicator can be a change in the stiffness or a change in a dimension, or it can be an increase of a crack length or things like that. Now, The next step is from this indicator here to the performance of the structure which we are interested in. And there are many different types of performances we could be interested in: reliability, safety, life cycle costs, or repair costs for the next year, or I mean, we can formulate any type of performance characteristic. But what we would like to be able to do is that we would like to be able to relate this change in the or this indicator we have eventually achieved through the event and the observations of the event on this performance indicator. And the way we do that is by formulating likelihoods. And that requires probabilistic modeling. Now then, using this information, this likelihood, describing how the observed indicator relates to the performance characteristic, we can feed that in to what you could term the knowledge. And the knowledge, of course, also has to take basis in all past experience. So you can imagine that this is driving around in a loop. So we are always accumulating knowledge at one point in time, becomes experience at the next point in time, and then feeds in the context of new information. And that knowledge facilitates decision making, and decision making is about taking actions including not doing anything, of course, always, and the actions are actually what manages the facility which we are concerned about. And this part here, you can say, is the part where we have the Bayesian updating, right? So that goes from the indicator to the development of the knowledge. And we can do this at many different scales, depending on the decision context. That's very important to appreciate. That the detailing, the level of details of the scale which we are looking at an engineered system is actually decided or determined. What people always ask me, but at what level of detail do we need to look at our system? And the decision analysis theory actually tells us exactly how to do that. So you need to identify a scale of detailing which facilitates that you're able consistently to differentiate, let's say, the benefit associated with different decision alternatives for the management of the system. That means that the detail of the system should be able to represent the characteristics of your system, the performance of your system, at a level where you can see in your representation of the system how your different decision alternatives can affect the performance of your system. So the scale is really related to, it has to be able to facilitate that you actually build in those decision alternatives into your modeling of the facility. That's the scale. And of course, that was not, let's say, a very, very so it's not like a recipe on how to decide on the scale, but it gives you good guidance. The scale should be able to represent your decision alternatives. And we will come back to the ranking of decision alternatives, but the ranking needs to be consistent. We also, so we have quite, let's say, a straightforward means for ranking decision alternatives. And you have all heard about cost-benefit analysis. In reality, what people understand to be cost-benefit analysis is strongly related to, let's say, simple forms of decision analysis. But there are other formulations of decision analysis which are a little bit more involving, a little more. They are stronger on the identification of optimal decision alternatives, especially with respect to collection of additional information. And they're not so well known. And what I'm stating here is that our field of engineering, probabilistic representation of the performance of structures and engineered facilities in general, I would say it very much took start with the people around Freudenthal in the 40s. And let's say based on further developments by Reifer and Schleifer, and then some pioneers from the United States, Benjamin and Cornell. If you can find that book on Amazon, I would strongly recommend you to do that. This is a super book, and these guys were so clever at this early point in time, just a few years after the publication by Reifer and Schleifer, which is, I mean, this is at the level Nobel Prizes, right? Then just a few years after, some engineers, they took over this completely and showed this is the way you do it in engineering. I find that to be pretty remarkable. Despite all these years, the merits, the strong potential of especially what we call the pre-posterior decision analysis has not really been appreciated. And this value of information analysis, which we are focusing on also in this course here, is a type of pre-posterior analysis. It's one of the interesting perspectives facilitated by this particular analysis. And you need to know this. We need to know this. Then, then also, there's a few points on this slide here. What I would like maybe to emphasize the most is this point here. Namely, that management of structural safety, reliability, and any other characteristics which you might be interested in with respect to the structure or the system, that the management of these performances is actually so very hardcore an information management problem. And I would like to stress that because my background and the background of the people who are teaching courses like these comes from typically from structural engineering somehow, right? And then we got involved in probabilistic modeling of mechanical systems and stuff like that from the corner of probability analysis. So from the concept of probability and Bayesian statistics. So this is where we come from. This is our origin. And we are a little bit failing in our community to take the step into the domain of information theory. But it would be really cool if some of you guys could find the energy and also, let's say, a less damaged mind, and then to see what things could be picked up in that domain of research, and how might that actually contribute to our domain. So we have been failing on that. It's up to you, also up to you. We will also make an attempt, but we're probably a little bit too late on the biological clock, really, to get into that. But it is enormously important to understand that what we are actually doing is that we are simply just managing zeros and ones, right? This is what we are doing. Anything we know about structures and engineered systems is knowledge. When we decide to build something by choosing a material of a particular grade, and we want to buy that in order to construct, for instance, a structure. Then you can swap a picture, and you can look at it that in the way that we are actually not buying a concrete structure of grade compression strains 40 megapascal. No, we are buying information which tells us something about the performance of the structure which will be built with that material. We are buying information, right? And then we are combining this information with all other types of information comprising, let's say, all the information of relevance for describing the performance of this system, this structure, or whatever engineered system that we want to establish and manage. And therefore, it is fundamentally an information management problem. We could probably talk much more about that, but there are lots of choices relating to information during the service lives of structural systems, like site investigations early on, laboratory experiments. Then there are choice of design methods, construction concepts, structural concepts. This is where engineers typically are. That they choose a static system, right? Then they choose some materials, dimensions, and then they make two lines under the result, and this is our structure. But there's a lot of other issues which are really important, namely quality control, later on in the service life assessments, maintenance strategies, monitoring strategies, and then also, of course, you need to take into account how do we want to replace the whole thing when it needs to be replaced and recycled. And the choices really define the prior knowledge we have regarding structural performances, risk, safety, service life, cost, but also whatever options there are to influence these characteristics over time. In the context of codes, In these days, we are looking at quite deep into, let's say, the revision of the Eurocode, which is ongoing. And this is just an illustration, illustrating here on the y-axis, we have consequences of failures. You can imagine that you have different types of classes of structures or structural systems, and depending on their use, the consequences of failure might be different. And here we have increasing consequences of failure. And then here, in this direction, we have the level of knowledge which is available in the best practice at the point where you make the design, right? And you can imagine that when you have different types, classes of structures, you can somehow organize them within this square. And if we know a lot, so if it's a very common type of structural system, then we are up in this end here of the figure. So maybe the consequences are low or maybe they're high, but we know a lot about it. We have a lot of experience, and the performances of the structures are well understood. The materials are well known. We have used them a zillion times before. There's nothing much new to be said about it. And this is a very good domain for simplified design concepts like semi-probabilistic safety formats deemed to satisfy rules can also apply in many cases. You don't really need to do much engineering because it has all been done before, right? But when we go out in this direction here, we have less and less experience, and we know less and less about the real performance of the structures. Maybe it becomes highly nonlinear with all sorts of discontinuities in the performance in the responses, that be geometrical or other type of discontinuities. It becomes it becomes very complex. And some of these systems which we are actually trying to model are super complex. I mean, these are, when we're dealing with really non-linear performances of structural systems, then this is definitely, this is not easy. And the uncertainty associated with what we know when we go up in this domain here just increases and increases. And that also means that concepts for the design, or say for the management of the safety and reliability of structures, as we go up into this domain here, if the consequences are high or moderately high, then no simplified way of doing that is adequate. And then you just simply just need to look a little more at the details and try to utilize the information you have in a more consistent manner to see how those uncertainties really affect what we know about the performances, right? And you see in the codes, what we try to do is that as we go up somehow in this direction here, we try to impose, we try to put requirements where we are increasing, let's say, the necessary efforts to know and utilize the knowledge we have. So we a little more control, a little more rigor as we go up into this domain here. Sometimes a lot more, right? Okay. There are different contexts basically different contexts where we can take benefit from structural health monitoring and value of information analysis. One, I will not have time to go through in detail, but it's all provided in the overhead, so go back to it. But prototype development is one of them. And prototype development is a little bit a curiosity, so it's a strange thing in structural engineering, right? Because normally structural engineering, this is really about making a new structure fundamentally every time. So the context is new, the structure looks slightly different than the latest structure which has been constructed using the same concepts, but it's located in a different place, the loadings are different, the use will be slightly different. So let's say mass production quality management rarely really applies in structural engineering. But when we look at some classes of structures, like, for instance, wind turbines, then we get closer to something you could call mass production. And some of the information you can collect over the service lives of these things here can actually be used as a part of, let's say, experimentally supported adaptive design optimization of these systems. So this is what I mean by prototype development. So you build 50 of these, you put them out somewhere, you observe, and then you realize, some of the performance characteristics were not quite optimal. The next one we will make with slightly different dimensions, for instance, here in this joint, right? And then you can do the same again. You observe and see, and then you adapt your design concepts. And in this way, you develop design concepts. Right. Then, of course, code making and code calibration for design and assessment of structures is one way. There are lots of things we can observe from the performance of structures in real life, which has a potential for calibrating our management of safety in regulations and in design codes. So typically we develop all these models trying to manage the safety, and we have targets, let's say reliabilities and stuff like that in the codes. But what we can do is, under certain conditions, we can go out and see how do the structures actually perform? How many types of failures do we get of this particular category? etc., etc. And we can relate that to the basis for the design which we have incorporated into the code. And if there is any important discrepancy, we are able to try to analyze why, and then that might be a reason to change a little bit the modeling behind the design codes and also some of the targets or a little bit the safety format managing. Then if we are dealing with engineered systems where we are able, of course, to observe how the systems are performing over time, it's an obvious application of value of information in structural health monitoring. So like observing how cracks develop, initiate and develop over time is a typical thing. The same applies for any type of corrosion phenomena or wear and tear phenomena. If we have an idea, so you, of course you can imagine that all sorts of things can happen to an engineered facility, right? But for those things which can happen where we have a prior idea on what is it that can happen, like when we can do that when we're looking at fatigue crack growth, right? We have models describing how these damages may evolve as a function of loading conditions. And based on all this knowledge, we are also able to focus on where to look for that type of damage and actually also when to start looking. So this is one of the situations where we have an idea. And there are many other cases. Corrosion of concrete structures of different types is also one of these things. Scour on the foundations of bridges. We also have models understanding which can guide us to look at the right places at the right points in time. And all this facilitates that we can manage the performances of the systems better. We can reduce risks at a cost, right? So this is an obvious. And of course, also for optimizing schemes which may already be risk-based or risk-informed schemes for maintenance planning, they can be enhanced by collecting additional information like from monitoring. Okay, we are getting closer to the very short break, but before we actually go to that, I would like to emphasize that IFA and SLIFER, they developed this Bayesian decision analysis. But a fundamental result they are relying on was actually a postulate from Bernoulli long time ago, namely that the ranking of decisions should take basis in or decision alternatives should take basis in the expected value of utility associated with these different decision alternatives, right? Daniel Bernoulli in 1738, he postulated that, and then he was fighting for a few years to try to prove it, but he didn't manage. It was only in 1947 by Neumann and Morgenstern and their four axioms of the utility theory that we actually know that Daniel Bernoulli's postulate was right. And this is a very strong thing. And please don't forget it and don't get confused. Don't get confused. If you have a complete model of all the relevant consequences for your system, that basically also means that you are able to evaluate all, different aspects of the risks in the system and the risks associated with different decision alternatives. Then when you are evaluating which are the best, second best and third best decision alternatives for managing for managing the performance of the system, then what you need to do is to calculate the expected value of utility. I'll talk a little bit more about utility in a few minutes, but what you need to focus on is the expected value of utility associated with the different decision alternatives. you calculate them, and then you see, okay, so which decision alternative will give me the highest expected utility, and that is the right choice, right? Okay? Never forget that. Starting point, you have already a complete model for all the consequences in your system, then we're only talking about expected value. There may be lots of, if you look at how people have tried to take benefit from decision analysis in all sorts of different areas, going from the insurance sciences over to mathematical modeling and decision making in the financial markets to engineering applications, you see all sorts of diversions from the fundamental principle of the axioms of utility theory, and you see people trying to accommodate somehow for the fact that the, let's say, the uncertainty associated with the utility and not only the expected value of the utility could in some ways play a role on which are the optimal decision alternatives. I'm telling you all this so that you don't make any mistakes, right? So this uncertainty associated with the value of utility is a little bit confusing for many people, but the reason why it is confusing is because they do not have a complete model. They do not take into account all the possible consequences which may arise from their decision making due to the system they're trying to manage, right? And in those cases, yes, you can argue, yeah, in that case it might be an idea to look a little bit on the uncertainty associated with the utility, because you have an incomplete model, right? And you would like to see how the incompleteness of your model actually influences your decision making due to the uncertainty. We can also do that, but we try not to do that. So what we really try to do is that we try to get the relevant complete model up and standing for the decision context which we are in. And then everything is very easy. Don't get confused. Expected values, nothing else. Now these people here in the Western world, they came up with a very nice framework for decision analysis. I also would like to to highlight that similar work was actually conducted in China by the Emperor Qianlong from the Qing Dynasty, and he was in force from 1735 to 96. A little bit interesting that it's the same period of time. And what is it that he writes here? This is from the Forbidden City, an inscription I found. The way of heaven is profound and mysterious, and mankind is difficult. Only if we make and follow a unified plan, we will be able to rule the country well. Only if we follow the doctrine of the mean. It's so small I can't read it, and it's so empty. But it says only if we follow the doctrine of the mean, we are able to rule the country well. And the doctrine of the mean, of course, I interpret immediately as the expected value, right? So this is the expected value principle, and they agree, I think this is a good point in time to take a small break. I'm going to introduce three different types of decision analysis, namely the prior, the posterior, and the pre-posterior decision analysis. And it's funny, one of the of the tools in trying to illustrate what is going on is that we, of course, the objective is to optimize decisions, maximizing the expected value of utility, as we talked about before, And for now, let's just associate with the term utility. And we will not have too much time to go into the detail on utility modeling. Let's just, for simplicity, associate with the term utility, a term which is more frequently used, namely benefit. So this is whatever benefit we can draw out of our decision making, and typically you will see that it's probably a good idea to look at benefit in terms of monetary net income. So any benefit, net of expenses, this is what we want to maximize. And it's fundamental here that we are buying information by choice of prior density. This is our tool, as I indicated before. We are managing information rather than physics, but we manage information by physics, right? And by also other ways of collecting information. So we have a variety of decision alternatives, as is illustrated here. Then we have the outcome of the system which we are trying to manage, which is associated with uncertainty. It's illustrated by the random vector x here, and this is a space of possible events which may take place. And at this point in time, you may remember this type of system model with exposure, direct and indirect consequences. This is where this actually comes into play, because here you have all the different scenarios which may take place and affect, let's say, the total consequences, which now we are focusing on the benefit associated with these scenarios. So we actually have complex scenarios of decisions, outcomes of the universe, and the sequences of say exposure events, direct and indirect consequences, and how that leads to benefits. And what we want to do is to maximize decision alternatives. We do this here. The decision alternatives A, so we are finding the best decision alternatives, maximizing the expected value of benefit, and I write here 1 prime, indicating this is based on our prior probabilistic models, which we have to describe how this system here actually works, right? And again, this can be this is an expected value, so we can easily write that in terms of the benefit multiplied by the prior probability density function of all the joint probability density function of all the, let's say, random variables which are used to describe the performance of the system here. So then we integrate over the entire outcome space of all uncertainties, and then we get the expected value. So. Then we optimize. So this is the way we do it. This is a prior decision analysis. I thought this would be a good illustration after the dinner yesterday. This is the hangover dilemma. You imagine that after the dinner, yesterday we are lying in bed in the morning and we have just a horrible headache. And we want to find out whether it's a good idea to try to move to the bathroom to find an aspirin and eat that, and then to see if it helps. But you feel so bad that it's actually a barrier to get out of the bed and move to the bathroom. This is a large inconvenience now. But you also know by experience that if you don't do anything, it will take approximately 6 hours before you feel well again. And this utility associated with these 6 hours is one disutility per hour you're suffering, right? Fundamentally, it's a decision problem. Should you move out there? The thing is that if you actually do move out there and you take an aspirin, then you know from experience that it doesn't always work. But in 80% of the cases, you know that the aspirin that they actually work. Now, looking at the discomfort by getting out of bed, the question is, and if the aspirin works, then it cuts off 4 hours of discomfort. So you only suffer 2 hours, and then the aspirin is fully functional, and you can get up and you can get alive again. But of course, everything depends a little bit on how you value this discomfort of getting out of bed, and you're a little bit in doubt. This is always the dilemma, right? Do I want to move out? No. Anyway, so here I try to put up the decision event tree. And I put on here the utilities, as I just explained. If you don't do anything, you have this utility of -6 hours, one per hour, and then you can analyze here. So if you actually do get out and try with an aspirin, it may work 80%. Then you have this utility, so you cut the pain, the suffering, 4 hours, but you have to get out of bed, so you have the this utility D there. It may also not work, so you multiply 0.8 with this here, and you add it to 0.2 times this. This is the expected value of utility associated with the decision alternative to get out of bed, and likewise here, if you stay in bed, you with probability 1, you have this utility of -6. Now you can easily just write up the balance equation here, and you find that the balance point is a discomfort of 3.2. So if you value the inconvenience of actually getting out of bed in the order of 3.2 hours of suffering, then you would not know exactly what to do. But if this discomfort is smaller than 3.2 hours, then you should get out of bed and eat that aspirin and get on with your life, right? Okay. Now the posterior decision, and this is maybe a little bit decision analysis for dummies, no? Or normal people, I don't know. it's close to real life, anyway. Now, the thing is that if we have any new information, so we start out with our prior description of the universe, and if we, and this is described by the joint, the prior joint probability distribution of all the uncertainties affecting our decision problem. Now we may get some additional information, and we want to be able to use this information to establish a new probabilistic model, and you all know how that works using the scheme of Bayes. So we formulate the likelihood function, which actually relates this information to our prior probability or our prior model, and we can calculate an updated joint probability density function for our uncertainties, and we mark that with, or indicate that with the double prime, so this is the posterior. So it's a likelihood multiplied by the prior, and then we need to normalize to get the, let's say, the total probability of the observation we have made. So we normalize with that. and of course, set the information we have, we can also index with an E describing the experiments by which we are achieving set. So now we get a little bit into, let's say, the planning of the collection of the information, right? So if we write the likelihood like this, then we have the experimental planning into the picture. So you already now see that we are trying to link, let's say, the information achieved about the performance of the system with a planning on how to get that information in the first place. And this is clearly a decision alternative, right? This is the plan for collecting additional information. But now, when we have this posterior probability density function, then we can just do a decision analysis again. Of course, this decision analysis now takes into account this new information. That's cool. We have a better picture of reality, and we can do the thing again, just like we did it the first time, but now everything is with a double prime, right? Nothing else has changed. But that's nice. When we talk about collection of information, you know, people, they speak about monitoring as if that is something very special and something distinct from other types of collections of information. But from fundamentals, it's all the same. Whether we call it this or that, it is collection of information. And it's just about how we plan to collect information. Then it falls into what other people call assessments or inspections, whatever. It's just information collection. Now, looking at the aspect of actually planning the collection of information, we can add that to the decision event tree, like illustrated here. So this is what we had before from here and onwards. Now I'm just adding here the component on how actually to collect the information. And so here you have the plans, the decision alternatives relating to how we want to collect the information. And here we have the set random vector indicating that we have an outcome space of different possible outcomes of the observations from the experiments, right? And it's clear now in this concept of prior posterior decision analysis that we can use this information to update our prior models, and then we get posterior models, and then we optimize decisions based on this posterior probabilistic model, just as we did before. But because we don't know the outcome of these observations here, we don't know. We only have a probabilistic description, right? Then we have to establish, let's say, conditional on the outcome, the expected value, the conditional expected values of utilities, and identify the optimal decision alternatives based on that. And then we integrate out over all possible outcomes of the experiments outside. And this we can write in this way here. So we can optimize the choice of experiment by optimizing here outside the posterior decision analysis optimization, which you have inside here, right? Here we just have the usual posterior decision analysis, but it's conditional on the outcome of set. Set is, however, a random variable because we don't know the outcome, and therefore we have to maximize outside, taking into account all the possible outcomes of the experiments in terms of the expected value of set. This is what we call the pre-posterior decision analysis, and it's cool from concept that it's like pulling yourself up in your own hair. In the sense that we are trying to take into account outcomes of information collections, even in the situation that we do not really know what those outcomes are. But the central thing here is that we model those possible outcomes using the prior model of the universe we are dealing with. So it's the best available knowledge we have about the possible outcomes of experiments given an experiment plan. So there's no hocus pocus here. And the thing why this actually makes a difference is that depending on the outcome of the observations, the outcome of the experiments, right, we are able to make optimal choices with respect to A, and they depend. They depend on these outcomes. They depend on how these what they tell us about the performance of the system, and thereby we can optimize. So we are actually changing something in the system depending on what we observe in the experiment. Otherwise, of course, collecting information about anything, if that information does not lead to a change of the system we are trying to understand better, that would not lead to anything. There has to be a specific decision associated or triggered by what we observe. Yeah? And that leads me to the possibly defect car dilemma. So we have two dilemmas today. And imagine that you have a car, and then suddenly Toyota, they send, and it's a Toyota, right, of course. And it's, or it's a, no, what should it be? I don't know. A Fiat! And then Fiat, in the radio, they say, well, if your car is built in the year 2000 to 2002, then it's really old. But you may also have a problem because we found a mistake somehow in the engineering. Now, this mistake is not in all the cars built in this period of time, but in some of them. And if it actually is a problem with your car, then so it belongs to a bad batch. Then there is a certain probability that it will fail, and this failure is associated not with any loss of lives, but severe engine damage, and it's going to cost you 10,000 euro, right? If that happens, then it can be fixed if it happens, but it's quite costly. And that's basically what they say. And then they also say that, of course, if your car is belonging to this bad batch, then the probability that it actually fails is 0.2. And that it survives is 0.8. So now, given this information, and also they say that approximately half of the cars produced in this period of time, they will have this type of defect, and the other half, they will be okay, they will be normal, right? And if your car is in a good batch, which has probability of 0.5, then you may assume that it will just continue according to normal business. Now, typically for Fiat, they don't offer you to come to the workshop and they will do the check for you free of cost. So it's up to you to decide on whether you actually want to spend money on it. And in order to identify whether it makes sense for you, you try to do a decision analysis. And this is really a collection of information problem, because you can choose to drive your car to the workshop, they can do the check, they immediately, and without any possibility of mistakes, they identify whether it's a good batch or a bad batch. And if it is a bad batch, of course, it comes out with the same probabilities as here, but if it is a bad batch, then they will do a repair. And but you know, workshops are not completely good, so they may do a successful repair or unsuccessful repair. I tried to I think I swapped probably these probabilities here. Or maybe I was really thinking about fear. No, I'm very biased, because this is how my workshop works. And okay, so never mind, the message is clear. If it is an unsuccessful repair, then you have a certain probability of failure and no failure. And if it is a successful repair, then everything is good. But, of course, if you go up into the decision of driving to a workshop, you have, let's say, the disutility associated with the cost of driving to the workshop. And now you can do the same thing again. You can multiply, let's say, probabilities according to the different branches here with the corresponding utilities and add them up for the different two decision alternatives, to do it or not to do it. And then you can see, by keeping this as an unknown, you can see what is the balance point. So if the cost of driving and having it checked is around, I think, 100 compared to the SIN, to the 10,000, then it actually makes sense for you to do this, right? So it needs to be a relatively inexpensive workshop. Now, so this is an information collection problem. So you're simply evaluating whether it makes sense, right? Another thing is that that it's a type of a situation where you have perfect information. So the information which you get from the workshop, so they immediately they are able to identify whether the car belongs to the bad batch or the good batch. In reality, there would be typically an uncertainty associated with that, and that has to do with, let's say, the quality of the collection of information. And in engineering, it's important to realize that this quality plays a very significant role. So we can go out, we can collect information about the condition of basically anything, but there is a certain probability that we are not getting the real picture when we collect the information. We can make different types of errors and mistakes, and we need to model that into the decision event tree. Anyway, by assuming perfect information, we can get a picture on what can be achieved, right? So this is like the ultimate use of information, of achievable information, which we can imagine. And then reality may reduce that because reality may not be that generous as we have here in this perfect.
Mike, just a comment. So, that result of 100, it's your decision about, for example, to, let's say, in a common sense, say, for example, if I go to make an evaluation of the repair, if it's above of 100, let's say, euros, perhaps it's not making sense to go to repair it.
Right.
Is that the decision, let's say?
That's the
if
idea.
It's
what you can do is that you can now start calling the workshops,
yes,
and you can ask this service here, what do you offer that for?
And they say, if they say it's above 100, perhaps you decide no.
Yeah, then you just wait for the thing to crash, right? Or you hope for the best.
That is the decision.
Yeah.
It's when you call it, you know what's the cost, and you compare with this value that you got from your decision.
Right. But then comes, I'm sorry guys, Jochen, if you could follow. But here I just want to make a remark regarding the complete incomplete system modeling, right?
No, I know that is not perfect.
But I want to make that remark because that's really important. So you could imagine that there is a household where if you lose 10,000 euro, you're really in deep shit, right? Because you don't have them on your bank account. It's a lot of money.
Yeah.
And if you actually, if you have to pay 10,000 euro, you may have to go out and get a loan, right? So this is an incomplete model because we don't take that into account. We have an unlimited budget consideration here.
Okay. That is
but if you wanted to make a complete model for which the expected value of utility really applies, right, then you would need to augment your utility modeling with all the possible, let's say, follow-on indirect consequences okay. associated with this event.
That value will change.
And then something additional will come on.
And which will go up that final value, correct?
Then you will have the 10,000 plus something. Yeah. Depending.
So that result is mainly in the case that you have unlimited budget.
Yeah. That this is already your full system. Right? Now, so when we talk about value of information analysis, what we really do is that we compare the optimal decisions and the corresponding expected, let's say, optimized expected value of utility for the pre-posterior analysis here with the optimized prior decision analysis expected value of utility. And the difference between the two, they show to what extent an experiment for collecting additional, an optimized experiment for collecting additional information, whether or not that will add, how much value it will add. Now there's a principle in decision analysis which says that information cannot hurt. So information cannot hurt, but it can be costly. And if collecting, so it will provide value, but the value may exceed, or let's say the value it will provide may be less than the cost of collecting the information. Okay? And we need to understand this difference before we can actually decide on whether we should collect the information. This is what we do, and Sebastian is going to talk much more about that. Yeah. What else would I like to highlight? Yeah, so here you see the prior decision analysis again. But in this figure here, I show different decision event trees. But what I want to illustrate here is that typically we look at the modeling of the world as if we actually know what world to model. But sometimes we do actually not fully understand which world we are in, so which is the actual system which we are trying to optimize decisions for. And we need to take into account, let's say, the possibility that there are alternative systems than those we are actually so that there may be a range of possible different universes, if you like. And fundamental different universes can be there can be many situations in practice where that concept comes up as a relevant concept. So you can imagine one universe is a universe where you are assuming that your system is influenced by, let's say, development of fatigue cracks, which are reducing stiffnesses in your system, right? And of course, when you measure your system, you can measure these reduced stiffnesses. You can monitor them, and then, based on this, let's say, system understanding that changes in stiffnesses, they originate from fatigue cracks. You can do all sorts of modeling. You can identify where you think they are, and you can also, optimize decisions on their management. But the changes in stiffnesses could also originate from, let's say, systematic changes over time of the support conditions for your structure. So it could be changes in stiffness of the soil, or it could be dirt in the abutments of a slab, which simply changes the static system, and therefore also changes what you observe and interpret stiffness changes. So it is, in a way, it is a change of the stiffness of the system, but has completely different, causes. And those two situations corresponds to two, let's say, competing systems, which may, with different degrees of appropriateness, be able to describe what you observe. But the thing is that the actions you need to try to take in order to manage the systems are completely different. So the actions that would be relevant in the case that your static system is simply changing due to, changed support conditions, those types of decisions you can manage this situation with are not the same type of actions which you can manage a fatigue deteriorating system. So you cannot take the optimal decisions in the fatigue context and scale them up or scale them down, and then you will find something which is useful for the changing support condition system, right? They do not belong in the same universe, and therefore it really is important that we take into account those non-affine mappings of different possible universes directly into the decision making. And one context which of course also is very relevant is the context of climate change. So you could also imagine that within one assumption for societal development, so this is one of the scenarios of the International Panel on Climate Change, they have different scenarios of societal developments, and then within each scenario there's a lot of uncertainty associated with what actually happens, but it's conditional on the scenario, right? So you can imagine this corresponds to optimal decision making for one scenario, this for another one, and this for a third one, accounting for all the involved uncertainties. And what we need to do is of course to optimize decisions with a due consideration of the uncertainty associated with what system we actually are dealing with. Now, when we look at systems in this way, we call it small world systems modeling and decision analysis. And if we look at everything, then you will find in the literature this is what we call the big world type of representation and decision analysis. Good. Well, I actually, I'll give you the choice. So we have a small example which is well documented in the PowerPoint presentation on how to do the prior, posterior, and pre-posterior decision analysis for a case where the problem is to decide on how long piles should be used as a support for a structure, and it's a problem to decide because we don't know the soil layer thickness down to firm ground, and we want piles which fit nicely, that they stand on firm ground somewhere down in the ground, and the thickness is associated with uncertainty, but it has only two discrete states. Either the soft soil layer is 40 feet or it's 50 feet. We don't know. And therefore, we have a choice between piles which are 40 feet long or 50 feet long. So this is fundamentally the decision problem. And then, besides these two choices, we also have a choice to make a test in order to get an estimate on the actual thickness of the soft soil. Right, and we can do that by decision analysis. We start with a prior decision analysis, the thing is that if we choose a pile which is 40 feet long and the soil layer thickness is 40 feet, then we have no disutility. Everything is good. We made everything right. And if we choose a 40-foot pile, and the depth is actually equal to 50 feet, then we had a problem because we had put the pile down, but it still has no firm ground. So we need to put a splice in, and then that is associated with a disutility of 400 monetary units. If, on the other hand, we choose a 50-foot pile and it turns out that the soil layer is only 40 feet, then when we get it down and we cannot get it further down, we just cut it off. And that is associated with a disutility of 100. And in the case that the soil layer is also 50 feet, everything is good and there's no disutility. So it's very easy to calculate the expected value associated with the two different choices. And now, in this example, we then introduce a testing scheme with imperfect information, whereby we can update the probability that we will go out to either of these two branches here, and then we do the posterior, and we can also do the pre-posterior. Now, it's going to take 10 to 12 minutes to show you that, but we are well into the coffee break already, so I will give you the option to say coffee break instead, and you can easily read this stuff if you want, but I'm very happy to pull you through in 10 or 12 minutes. Yes. So, what would you like?
Continue.
Okay. It's your own choice. And we are now on 41 of God knows how many. Okay, so I already described the problem. We are describing these two choices by A0 and A1 here. And the two states of nature, it's a very funny nature, the true state of nature only has two possible states. It would be nice if it's like that. It's never like that. Okay, so I already said the two decision alternatives, 40 feet, 50 feet. Now the prior probability which we have on the two states of nature, the prior probability, this is from experience and judgments from geotechnicians. They are fantastic in making spooky judgments, and we don't never know where they come from. but they can do that. This is what they do for a living. And then we have the utilities I explained before. So what we typically do is that we put up a box here to the different decision alternatives to show the expected value associated with it. Different decision alternatives. So 0.7 times 0 plus 0.3 times 400 is 120. 0.7 times 100 plus 0.3 times 0 is 70. Now, these are the expected values of utilities associated with decision alternatives A0 and A1. And it, of course, it's obvious from this little analysis, maybe we would also know it by stomach feel or whatever we call it, that would be a logical thing to do, but here it's documented that the right choice is to take a 50-foot pile, and if something goes wrong, we'll just cut it off, right? And we can write that up, what I just explained, so it's a minimization problem of the decisions, and now we choose the decision yielding the lowest expected value of cost, 50-foot pile, right? Now we have Bayes. These are the prior probabilities of the two different states of nature. And here we have experiment outcomes given two possible different states of nature, right? And then we are normalizing. But what we really want to achieve is a posterior probability distribution or probability assignment of the different states of nature. Using information. Whoa, and we know all this. Now, this testing scheme here, this is a fantastic testing scheme. So the idea is that we make a small explosion on the surface of the soil, like this. And then when we do that, we have a microphone on the place where we make the explosion, and of course the microphone is able to record at the exact point in time when the explosion goes off, and then comes down the sound wave through the soil, and it hits at some point in time, not after very long time, it hits the hard soil layer, or let's say the intersection between the soft and the hard soil, and then comes up a reflection, and that hits the microphone, right? Now, by analyzing this a little bit and making some averages and some modeling of the velocity of sound through different types of soft soils, and by the knowledge we have about this soft soil here, we are actually able to, we are actually able to estimate the layer of the soil based on this type of measurement, right? And here, conditional on the true state of nature, so given, you can imagine that now we have conducted this equipment, zillions of tests, and we have found that given the true state of nature is 40 feet, the likelihood that we will actually get a 40-foot indication is 0.6. So it's not perfect. You see, it's not perfect. I will come back to that. This, I don't know, it was probably a geotechnician who had developed this equipment, because it also gives a possibility for a 50-foot indication, and the probability of that, the likelihood of that is 0.1, given the true state of nature is 40. But I don't know why. They devised this equipment, so it also comes up with an indication of 45 feet. This is, you never get something which really fits you. There's actually a relatively high likelihood of getting such an indication in the situation we have a 40-foot soil layer. And now, of course, the true state of nature can also be 50 feet, and based on all this testing of the equipment, we have the associated likelihoods. 0.1 to get a 40-foot indication, 0.7 to get a 50 feet, that's relatively good, and 0.2 to get this thing we don't really know what to do with, right? These numbers, do they make sense? They make sense. So well, you sum up to one. That's good. What else can we say? Yes, maybe. So this 0.6 is lower than the 0.7, and so that physically makes sense. That if the true state of nature is that we have 50 feet, then let's say the uncertainty associated with estimating the velocity of the sound wave through the soil and back again probably reduces, right? So let's say variability in whatever soil characteristics there may be is probably bigger for a shorter distance than it is for a longer distance. So to me that also makes sense. So I think this is a plausible model, and this is the type of model which you really need in order to be able to assess the value of information. So you need a description like this. You need the likelihoods of all the possible different indications it provides relative to all the possible true states of nature. This is a likelihood function, and we need that. And if providers of monitoring equipment or inspection equipment cannot also deliver something like this, then it's not good. It's not good. We should not be satisfied. This is key. I mean, if we don't have this, we don't have any real means for assessing the value of information. I mean, it's fundamental, right? That you want to know. It's like when you go to the doctor and he says, yes, we have a positive find for you, then you would like to know, okay, so with what probability does that mean that I will die next year, or tomorrow, or in 100 years, right? So this is fundamental. Now, we can update using Bayes' formula, of course, our prior model using these test results. You have the prior probability, and then you have the likelihoods you see here. This is actually the likelihood of getting Z2, and Z2 was a 45 feet indication, given that the true state of nature is 40 feet, so it's 45 given 40. We just go back here. Oops. Given the true state of failure, true state of nature is 40 feet, so it's 0.3, right? This is the situation. And this is what you see here, and then multiplied by the prior probability which we have. And then I skip the normalization. We can always normalize. So we just focus on the products here. And then we normalize to make sure that the sum is equal to 1. This is what we do here. So this is now our posterior model. And now we can analyze based on a test result which gives us a 45 feet indication. Based on this information, we can make a posterior analysis. So we imagine that we have conducted one experiment. The result is a 45 feet indication. This is our posterior model, and this is our updated decision analysis. This is what it provides. We see that it changes a little bit the numbers here, but the decision is still the same. Choose the 50-foot pile. Yeah, so we can write it up a little more formally. Now, in the pre-posterior analysis, what we do is that we imagine not only that we have conducted one experiment and we get a 45 feet indication, but we have conducted also the experiment where we get a 40 feet indication and the experiment where we get a 50 feet indication. And for those additional two cases, we also update using Bayes and we conduct the posterior decision analysis. And we identify for each of those cases the optimal decision alternative. We can do that. We can certainly do that. You can imagine this is what we have done here. So we minimize the expected value of cost given the different possible outcomes of the experiments. And now what we need to do is that we actually need to integrate out over all the possible outcomes of the experiments. And this is what we do here with the sum. This is just an integration. And we weigh those expected values of benefits, or let's say costs, with the prior probability that we will actually get this experiment outcome, which we have conditioned on. And we do that for 40, 50, and 45 feet, right? So what we need to do first is to establish the probability, the prior probability of having these different outcomes of the experiment. And this is what we do here, looking at the total probability theorem. So we say that the prior probability of getting a particular decision outcome here can be written as the likelihood of getting this particular indication given the true state of nature is equal to 40 feet multiplied by the prior probability of having a 40 feet true state of nature plus the likelihood of having the indication of interest conditional on the true state of nature being equal to 50 feet multiplied by the prior probability of having a soil layer of 50 feet. We can do that for the two cases, for the three cases, the three different possible indications, and you just get these corresponding, I don't know if you can see it, but yes, you see it now. These are the prior probabilities of the different experiment results, right? So that's pretty easy. Now, whoops. Now we can do the. it's complicated. Now we can do the optimization here, the pre-posterior analysis, and we find that that in the case. So we find that conducting the experiment will. Oops. Let's jump. Yeah, I want to jump to this one here. So this is now we have evaluated these prior probabilities of the different indications, and we have calculated not only for the case of the 45 feet indication, but also for the three other ones, the corresponding maximized expected values of utilities. And those were for the 45 feet, you remember it was 78. That was by choosing a 50-foot pile. We got that. This here corresponds to the choice of a 50-foot pile, and this here for choice of a 40-foot pile. And these are the corresponding probabilities of getting a 40-foot indication, a 50-foot indication, and a 45 feet indication. And of course, this can be added up, and then you get an expected value of losses or benefits, or you can call it utility, which is equal to 40. And that was for the pre-posterior analysis, where we had the option of making the experiment, so where we actually looked at the optimal decisions we could make given that we conduct an experiment. And you remember the prior decision analysis, where we did not account for any possible experiment or results from experiments. The optimal choice was to choose a 50-foot pile, right? And that gives us an expected value of cost equal to 70. Now, what we do here is that we simply subtract this number here from the 70, and then we get 30. And the 30 monetary units, they correspond to what the cost of an experiment can. So this is the maximum cost. If it's more expensive, it doesn't make sense. If it's less expensive, it makes good sense to make the experiment, right? So this is the value of information in that simple case. And now I think it's high time for coffee. Yeah.